Okay, I hope that I'm not going to be accidentally like doxing myself or something. Here's the screenshot. This is from my Pink Bike account, which is directly associated with Trail Forks, and I have my Strava connected to my Trail Forks as well. This is only going to be relevant if you're like a biking person and you use those apps or platforms. So I was suspended for 10,000 hours based on spam, which there was really no spam. What happened was that I noticed that there was a trail. Well, first of all, I noticed a YouTube video by somebody, and they rode this trail called Ridge, or Ridgeline, as they called it. Or I guess it's just the Ridgeline or Ridge Trail, whatever. On Trail Forks, it's just listed as Ridge. That's it. One reason that's a problem is because it's such a short name that it's really easy. I'm sure there's other cities, towns, areas that have, you know, a similar name, like a trail that is listed as Ridge. Trail Forks will tell you when your name is the same as someone else's trail or too close to someone else's trail or whatever, and then get you to change it, usually. But this one's just called Ridge. That's it. So the thing is that there were about 6 or 7, I think, videos there, and none of them were from Lethbridge. There's actually one that was close, because it was in Alberta. It was Drumheller. The other ones, I think there were some in the States, and, like, there's some I don't even know where they were supposed to be from. But none of them were this trail. So I commented one comment on each of those and said, hey, just letting you know, like, this has been misattributed. This trail and this video don't go together. Like, your video is of somewhere else. You put it in Lethbridge by accident. Just once. And then I reported and flagged them as well, because maybe those people don't... Some of them were years old. So I was like, hey, well, I'll report them and flag them to the moderators of Trail Forks and Pink Bike so that they can take care of it. I did this only once. It was about 6 or 7 videos. I did them all in a row because they were all misattributed. So then I go onto Trail Forks and I was just like, I don't remember what I was trying to do. And then it said this. It said that my account had been suspended. And I have 9,991 hours remaining. Well, it was 9 hours ago when I commented on those videos. Therefore, 10,000 hours. Banned. Auto ban. But it was like, how many comments would I have been allowed to do within, like, a 5-minute period? Apparently 6 or 7 is spam. It wasn't 6 or 7 to the same person. There were different videos, and it was only one comment on each. So this is crazy. I just think that's incredibly dumb. That's a really dumb auto ban. Like, that doesn't... Like, dumb, like, literally, it's not a very smart system. It's not a very smart, whatever the coding was there, being like, oh, if someone comments 6 times in 5 minutes or whatever it was, ban them. Like, well, wouldn't it be commenting on the same thing over and over again? Wouldn't that result in a ban? Maybe like a ban of like, I've never been banned before. I've never done anything on there. And that's the thing. I had to email the mods. Who knows how long it'll take them to respond or reverse a ban if they're going to. And I had to tell them, like, every time when I ride a trail, I do a trail log, or like a trail report, I should say, that talks about the conditions, and like I just mark it like, yeah, it's good, or like, no, it's kind of muddy, or whatever. That's contributing positively. I add videos that really help the community. I take pictures, I add some trails from time to time, like, or whatever. Like, I was like, how does this result in like a ban from, this is part of that. This is part of that being like, I'm trying to clean up this trail on Trail Forks so that people get the right information, that they're not looking at a trail that doesn't belong there. Ridiculous.
I've always wanted to go down this, but it sketches me out. And I'm not wearing pads today. Well, I'm not wearing them anymore. I don't know. Like, it's not that bad. I don't know. I think I'm just gonna send it. If I wreck without pads, I guess I wreck without pads. I kind of forgot about this challenge that I wanted to try and attempt here. Rolling up to it is sketchy because the sand, it's kind of hard to see, like, the drops, because there's like one kind of little step and then there's like two back to back, and it kind of looks like one because of the sand. I'm gonna let these folks pass through first and then I'm gonna give it a shot. Yeah, that's not that bad. Don't be a tool. It's not that bad. It's really not. Wasn't in the right gear for the climb, but that was pretty cool. Now I know I can do that pretty easily. It's all the mental game. So first off, I didn't make it up the climb the second time around. I did about like 75% of it and had to start walking. But this is what I really want to talk about. Some idiot who circled this and put a heart and an arrow. I don't know how many years this stencil piece has been up, but I saw it like the first year I was here. So almost 4 years ago. So I guess like, yeah, 3 years ago or something in the summertime, I saw this stenciled stormtrooper piece and I was like, oh, that's really great. I took a picture of it. I'll insert the picture here before some fucking idiot completely ruined it. If, to me, what this says is, oh, this is a depiction of love. I almost didn't get it because I'm such an idiot. I should point it out to other people in case they don't get it, because I almost didn't get it because I'm so dense that I need to point it out to other people. And you just ruin the piece by doing that. Like, it's so aesthetically disgusting now. Ugh. Idiots. There's two moments. Well, there's plenty. There's a couple different types of like highs from biking that I get. Ooh, podcast started up. Excuse me, Edward and Mark. One of them is like this. It's like a, there's like some physiological highs and there's like some more like psychosomatic highs. So like the feeling you get when you accomplish something you couldn't accomplish before is like, hell yeah, like I did that. Like that's kind of a high. But then there's like what people often term as runner's high. So just by like getting all these chemicals flowing like crazy and really working yourself to the edge of your capabilities or surpassing your previous capabilities and getting this physical, very real like runner's high that courses through you, that's an excellent feeling too. I mean, that couples with the other thing, because I find for me, I usually don't get that unless I have really, really pushed to the edge of my limit or stretched my limits from where they were before. And then there's also sometimes like something I rarely ever get anymore. And it's this feeling of when you, it's like when you have the runner's high and then you get to just, it's like feeling totally depleted. It's like feeling like you are just so physically depleted and then you get to just sit or lay down. like almost immediately after, because I got my runner's high moment and I felt like total depletion and just like, man, I got nothing left. Did everything I could. The problem is, because I don't live in Lethbridge anymore, I don't bike to and from trails. And so that moment of like being able to just completely collapse and relax until I feel good again, until I feel like able and like, I mean, I feel good, like mentally and emotionally, and I guess physically, but I'm tired physically. But like, I always have to come back to the car and load up the bike, and like, I can sit for a minute, but it's just not the same. I gotta get going, I wanna get somewhere more comfortable, whatever, right? I really miss that, I miss that. And I didn't realize how good I had it. Cause I mean, like, having the bike rack is like the biggest crazy advantage. And even if I did live in Lethbridge, I would use it to go to trails. I'd rather spend more kilometers on trails than I would in the city. But maybe there are some times where I still would, you know, decide to bike from home or something. And I really miss just like, I haven't felt completely depleted in a while either. Like, I mean, that one time, like 2 weeks ago, where I felt like sick, that was something else. I don't know what that was about. But I mean, like this being like, man, I'm healthy, I feel good, I really put in the work today, and I am drained. And I rarely get that feeling anymore, but when I do get it, I'm like, oh man, I wish I could just chill right now. Like, yeah, the studio, that would be like a time to do that maybe. Then I gotta go up the stairs and yeah, anyway, I'm ranting, I'm tired. Hello, dear friend. I love you. These are some of Randy's most recent paintings. And there's this one too. But I get to keep this. I love it. It's the smallest, I think, piece of art I may own. But oh man, I love it. It's friggin' fantastic. As I treat it with respect and care. I love this one on the corner too. This green, red, blue, oh, it's tasty. Just gorgeous. Anyway, the reason I wanted to show those real quick is because Randy has accused me of being envious of her newfound, I don't know what to call it, and she's not wrong. I am going to start off with the definition of envy before I explain that yes, I am envious. Painful or resentful awareness of an advantage enjoyed by another, joined with the desire to possess the same advantage. Now, the word advantage in there is a little whatever, but I guess there's other definitions too. And this is no dictionary.com. This is the true, you know, Merriam-Webster we got here. Yeah. So, yeah, we'll just stick with that definition. That's the best one. So again, painful or resentful awareness. I am not resentful. We'll start there. Not at all. But I am aware, painfully aware, of the advantages enjoyed by her, joined with the desire to possess the same advantage. Again, the word advantage there is like whatever, but I am painfully aware of like, man, she is selling paintings. She's getting requests for commissions, just like... like that. Like, she started painting, like, two weeks ago? And now she's sold more paintings than I have in months. She has been requested for commissions, and I haven't had a request for commissions in I don't know how long. So, I'm very painfully aware. And, of course, I would like... I am wanting the same thing. We'll call it an advantage or not, or whatever. Just the same success or whatever else. I'd be like, hell yeah, why wouldn't I want to be selling paintings? But it's not in a resentful way or to drag her down, because the other day she was like, your eyes are turning green. And I was like, I am super pumped. I'm like super happy for her. And this is why, another reason why I show off her stuff. And I'll put her link tree in the description of this video again above mine, so you see it right away. Because I want to pump her up, and you should definitely check out her stuff. And you should buy her things, because they are beautiful. But hell yeah, of course, like, I feel that. I'm like, wow, like, I would feel, I mean, if I was selling just as much as her, or more,
I would feel 100% positivity without anything negative. I recognize a negative feeling in me, but it's not resentfulness or bitterness towards her. It's like a bitterness of just like, just the fact that I, like, why wouldn't I want the, like, you know, I think it's, that's what it is though. Is this like, but I want this thing that I don't have and I have no real control over getting it. If I start making comparisons and stuff, then then it might turn into resentment because I have said even like, man, you just started painting like 2 weeks ago and I've been painting abstracts for like almost a decade and a half or like over a decade for sure. And just like, I can't get anywhere with it the way that you are right now. And the fact is that people are responding to her work. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with my work, but people are responding to her work. More people are responding to it. And buying it and requesting commissions and supporting her and blah, 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 blah. And that's fantastic. But there is that part of me, like this part of me that I want to be honest about that is like, man, like, it makes me feel like I'm spinning my wheels because people aren't responding to my work. There could be a plethora of reasons besides style. Part of it is size and price and whatever. However, I just do think we have different styles and people are responding to the style of her work. I mean, if she priced higher and made bigger pieces and thus needed to price higher, maybe some of those people wouldn't be interested anymore. I don't know for sure. Either way, it's a bitterness not towards her, but towards the situation of being an artist. Because I wonder what will happen if/when she moves on to bigger work using like deep profile canvas and stuff. That because it costs more to purchase, it will have to cost more to sell. Or I guess the materials cost more, thus people, I mean, the pricing of it will have to cost more. And I'm wondering if that'll happen to her too, where it's like we just have a stack of stuff that we're making that we can't turn around nearly as fast as we make it. And I have slowed down. That's the thing. It's like so funny how, man, she injured herself painting. She, just like her right arm, just like, because this muscle that you, like when you're clenching, right? Like right in, I don't know what it is there, and like her bicep and stuff, like is in pain because she went from not using her right hand in that fashion ever to like painting for hours at a time and then a couple days later doing it again. Anyway, I went off the rails there. I'm just saying that like she's been doing so much work and gratefully people are responding to it and she's able to sell that work. I don't have that. I am not making work as quickly. And if I was, then frick, we would need another storage unit just to put stuff in there because I'm working on bigger things and like whatever. And my stuff isn't selling. So yeah, of course there's like a bitterness there or a negativity feeling. I shouldn't say of course. There is for me. That's just a part of who I am right now. But it doesn't take anything away from her. I don't think it should. It shouldn't be seen that way because I don't feel that way. I'm not dragging her down. I'm feeling like, man, like I want to be there as well. And for some reason, I can't gain traction there. Again, making the comparisons is going to be really unhealthy, right? So starting to do that would be not a good thing. But speaking of tired arms, I keep switching arms because my arms are tired from biking. Anyway, I'm going to paint a piece today. And I think it's going to be this one. So, yeah. That'll be nice. Or maybe it'll be that one in the corner. I don't know what I'm going to be feeling. I'm going to be painting pretty quick. But I just don't know what I'm going to be feeling yet. So, we'll see. But anyway, I don't know. I just wanted to talk about that because it was just like a thing where she was like, your eyes are turning green. And I was like, okay, yeah, but it's not dragging you down, babe. Like, it's the fact that I'm just like, man, I really wish I'd be selling work. Like, I am super happy and proud of her for selling work. And even just making work. Not even the selling part. Because that's, like, not in her control. I mean, it is and it isn't. She, I think, she works social media better than I do. And that's a skill that I need to build on. But, I mean, she can't force people to like her stuff and buy it. She's putting it out there. She puts it out there, I think, a little better than I do. But I don't know. I mean, sometimes I feel like we're doing exactly the same thing. Anyway, comparisons. Get that out of there. I'm just pumped about her passion for painting.
So, of course, as soon as I talked about, you know, the green-eyed monster, I, a couple hours later, sold a painting on Etsy. That piece right there, which I will insert a picture of here. Because I didn't make this video till I boxed it up. I'm gonna go and ship it right away. I'm gonna go to the old post office and get that done. But it's a piece called Breach, which I underpriced by like half of what I believe it's worth. I've had it for 2 years, I think. Possibly three. It is, I don't know, it's one of the pieces that I really, really like, but it's one of those ones where I can see how it's not the traditional aesthetic beauty that a lot of people may desire or think of or look for. It's definitely like an artist's art piece, put it that way. And I love it. But I'm going to insert that picture here, and I'm happy to get that sale because that helps me pay for my AMA insurance. So cool. And, of course, I am here meeting someone to make a sale for Randy as well. So, anyway, that's good. I'm getting more stuff on the Etsy store because I did sell that necklace to someone in the UK. So now I'm putting more of the necklaces up. Just takes some time to do that. And I've got so many damn necklaces. So buy some necklaces. Look at them on the Facebook shop because they're all up there. Also, they're slowly getting on Etsy. Or you can just message me. Do it. So I'm about to put a finish on this piece. And I had some trouble coming to a resolution with it and really finishing it. Mostly up here. That was the last kind of bit that I fixed and figured out. But since it's something that we've mentioned in the podcast and something I've mentioned previously in the vlog, I thought I'd mention it now too, that I came to a place where I found some growth, I guess, with being patient, with stopping and leaving. Like, it wasn't resolved, and I didn't have time to finish it, or else it would have been late, and I chose to be on time rather than continue pushing it. And usually my thing is, like, I just need to make a painting in one sitting. If it's an abstract painting, like, it just has to be done in one sitting, and I just didn't have the time for it. I shouldn't have started it, but I did, because I was like, oh, I can do it, and I was just really hungry to paint. Really needed it, but I found this moment of growth where, yeah, I was able to just be like, hey, I often talk about life being like an inspiration for my work, and life is full of interruptions and whatever else, right? And it's going to happen, and that's just going to feed my work the next time that I go into this space. Will I be in the exact same place I was mentally and emotionally when I started it? No, I'm not going to be in the same place, but that's okay, and that's just what the piece is and what it has to be about. So, success. Climbing that is gonna be fun later. Not. Well, caught a pedal. Caught a pedal, that's all. Caught a pedal while I was tired, and whew, that's what happens. depleted, not defeated. That's the new shit. The new mantra. That's it. Depleted, not defeated. Just came back from doing Duncan's Ride for the first time. As you saw, I fell. There were some climbs. I did not make them. I went and did river trials after that. I was already tired. I thought that I would, you know, gain some energy back because it's an easy trail. But did that back-to-back, came back to the bottom of Coal Banks and decided to come up Coal Banks back to the city. That is a trail that is an ascent that I've been able to do for like 2 years every time, except for, like, I mean, the first three times I had to walk parts of it. Then after that, consistently, I've made it. It's not a fun ascent, but it's also not like this crazy test on, you know. However, the last time, I believe it was the last time, no, it was the time, 2 times ago, I was not feeling well, and I don't know, I was so off and just like completely drained way too quick, and I could not make it up. So since then, I've been like, oh man, like, what if I don't make it again? The thing is, this is such a mental, I don't want to call it a game, but it's such a mental exercise, mountain biking, and I'm sure other sports, obviously, like a lot of sport, if not all sport, and other things, not just sports, hobbies and art and whatever. But I'm just realizing more and more and more how this is teaching me discipline, or I am choosing to let it teach me discipline. I am choosing to learn discipline via mountain biking. Discipline with my mentality, with my confidence, with my unwillingness to stop. Because it's really hot. It's like 35 degrees. I did not drink enough water. Water's not staying in my system very long, and I keep forgetting that in this heat. So, I did not drink enough water before I left. I didn't pack enough water. I should have had a Camelback or something. But anyway, it was just... Yeah, I was completely depleted. I was exhausted before I started my ascent back up to the city. I thought I was going to have to get off on Coal Banks and walk a bit, but I did not. I, like, struggled through it, and I was able to do it. When I got to the top, both my calves started cramping. So the last 10 minutes of my ride back here, even though it was, like, pretty chill on scenic, both my calves were cramping, which is horrible. I mean, if one's cramping, that's bad enough, but then you can overcompensate on the other side and do some things to kind of like let that leg chill, but both were cramping. Anyway, I'm just really happy with the work I put in today. You know, trying that trail for the first time, falling within like the first 5 minutes or so, sucked. Those climbs that I couldn't make that I still had to walk up, I mean, that sucked, but whatever. And then, you know, I decided to do this easy trail, river trials, but on that trail, there's a feature that's like a very optional feature, and I get paranoid and scared of it all the time. I barely made it over today, but I did. And so I was happy about that. It was a really slow ride on River Trials, there and back, but I was able to clean the whole thing, slow and steady, including extra challenges. And yeah, I don't know. It's just, that's, the main thing is that how it tests me mentally times with like today with endurance, I pushed until the edge. I pushed until, like, I didn't know if I was gonna make it. How will I know though until I, unless I keep going and going and going and going? There's obviously times where it'd be unsafe to push yourself too far, like riding super crazy trails while you're exhausted. You know, I didn't get super exhausted until I was already on an easy trail and on the way back up, where it wouldn't have been, if I had to get off my bike, if I fell off my bike out of exhaustion, nothing would have happened. I would have fell into a shale path. Nothing bad would have happened at all. So that's part of it too, is knowing when to stop. But how will I get to a state of complete depletion unless I push until I get there? I won't know that. Like, quitting too soon is a thing. And like, I was able to make that ascent. That's not, that shouldn't be a huge feat on a normal day, but today was not a normal day. And like I said, I came back up, both my calves were just cramping. Things I could do to prevent that in the future for sure, but in the meantime, I pushed, and I pushed until I had nothing left, and I was able to complete it. And if I didn't complete it, I still would have been like, okay, well, I know that I pushed as hard as I could. But there's something obviously extra satisfactory about knowing that you wanted to give up, you wanted to walk, you wanted to get off your bike, you wanted to stop and make the pain go away for a minute and take a breather, but you weren't at your limit yet and you knew it and you kept going. I hate the fact that this is a huge pat on the back, but this is something that I'm like learning, is that I can teach myself discipline and exercise discipline and mental fortitude and advancement through mountain biking.
Okay, so here's a quick little sneak peek at some more collabs that Randy and I have done. I just did both of these today. I'm really happy with this one because it was a challenge and something new. A black and white piece, which I had not done before. All the rest were just full color, and I wanted to like add to this bleakness somehow with color, and I didn't really know how to do that. She gave it the title of Abysmal, and I think I added Slow Apocalypse to it. I have it written down somewhere, but I'm really enjoying the interference red that I got here in the clouds, and then the drips coming down too. So yeah, that's a little sneak peek at those. I did another one a couple days ago, so there's only one left to do, and that will be a challenge, but those will be up at the Penny for a little while, starting, I think, the first week of September, I think September 5th. So that's cool. Yeah, I did a bunch of riding this past week. Well, not a bunch, more than normal. I got out on two different days to go ride and record. But I hit several trails at once that were worthy of having videos up. So other than this, there's a conversation, which is about nature versus nurture, which I really enjoyed. And then there's a whole whack of new raw rides. I would say if you, you know, are not like in the Lethbridge area and looking for like trails to find and like all that stuff, they're not crazy exciting. But yeah, there's gonna be some more exciting stuff, I guess, this weekend that'll be in the vlog, and maybe it'll be a raw ride, I don't know, because I am a little nervous, but someone is gonna tow me in Tabor and take me on some trails I've never gone on before, and I've never been towed in by anyone before, so that's a whole other thing. But yes, other than the conversation, there's a whole bunch of raw rides up this week. And, yeah, still doing a podcast with Randy. That is going, still going. So, good. I feel really weird right now wrapping this up, and I don't know why. Anyway, yeah, so more collab stuff. That's been good. That's been fun. And, we will see you on another time.